Hi, I'm Stewart Copeland, and this is my video rewind on Smooth. It's hard to remember which was the first because Roxanne was released several times and it disappeared without a trace the first time. And because we were off in Germany, then I released a record of my own called Clark Kent, and we went on Top of the Pops, and that was kind of the first time we were on TV, was as Clark Kent Band. When this video was made looks a little bit later. It was like second or third time around that Roxanne finally hit. Walk the streets for money. You don't care if it's wrong or if it's right. Some of it is a real gig. It's intercut with real gig. I think they came and they filmed us at the sound check and then got shots of the audience that night. And by the way, I can tell from Sting's bass that this is a little bit later. He's got his fretless there because he started out with his Fender P bass. And when he got this one, it was a little bit later. Videos were a big thing already because of Top of the Pops. And also countries like Germany, you could tour Germany just doing miming in all the pop shows. And so videos were already a thing, and MTV just came along and kind of capitalized on it. Oh, how young and innocent and brave, gazing upon a distant horizons. Yes, it warms the cockles of my heart to know that I was once young. I hope that someone gets my, I hope that someone gets my message in a bottle, yeah. This is the dressing room of the, the Lyceum downtown London. And that's just the dressing room. And in those days, videos were pretty simple. You just hose down the band with a camera. The band hams it up in front of the camera. And that's like one or two takes of us just hamming it up in the dressing room, intercut with live stuff. And Sting got yet another bass in that. So this is when we were definitely on our way. We were going places by now. They gave me a cymbal and a chair. Hey, give me a cymbal and a chair and I'll give you a beat. Just give me something to bang and I'll bang it. Back then, you just hose down the band and hopefully they're photogenic. Which in the case of us, we got Sting in front there. That's photogenic. But by the way, can I just comment that this is one of the rare times that the drummer in the band gets to do something other than just kind of groove around, trying to look cool while in fact looking utterly daft. Yes, Walking on the Moon. That was actually at Cape Kennedy, or is it Cape Canaveral? Changes name every so often. But we got to play Walking on the Moon, and I got to play a Saturn V. Not many drummers can say that. Drummers play a Ludwig Classic, or the Rogers, the Gretsch. I got to play Saturn V. You know, in Message in a Bottle, I was banging on a chair. Here, I'm banging on a spaceship. The sound was not bad, actually. Pretty good sound. Kind of tinny. It was kind of more high-pitched and tinny sounding than you would expect from such a substantial piece of engineering. But it's all actually pretty lightweight. They ran us out there. We shot the thing. Like we say, we just hose it down, no concept, no storyline, nothing, just bang some stuff. And try and look as cool as possible while someone else is doing the actual singing. Well, yes, Don't Stand So Close to Me was actually a proper video shot by a director with a concept and had an idea of a storyboard and everything like that. And there is Stingo dressed up as a teacher momentarily before his shirt comes off. I love taking his shirt off. Me, not so much. I didn't have quite that physique. But there he is all dressed up as a teacher.
Oh, man. That went over a storm,
you know, because we, at this phase, we were kind of a teeny bopper band in the early stages before our musicality asserted itself. We were on all the teeny bopper magazines and as three pretty boys. Go figure. Our intention was to be punk rockers, and we ended up as a boy band, Rough Justice. We're all dressed as teachers. Look at that. We all got those gowns on. That's cool, because they kind of flow. And look at me standing there trying to look cool without anything to bash. That's the drummer's lot in a rock band, twitching along while the singer gets to sing and the guitar gets to strum a guitar that isn't plugged in, but the drummer just has a pair of sticks and looks daft bouncing around. The way to handle that is to look mildly cheesed off. Every Little Thing She Does Is Magic is the police version of The Who trashing their equipment. Because we're at one point we're dancing around on this, you know, $200,000 Neve console. But we weren't actually. We weren't even thinking about that. We weren't thinking about destruction because we lived in that studio. And one of the easiest ways to get in and out of that room was over the desk. And we were all young, fit, and athletic. And so we just leap over the desk. We knew where the handholds were. And so at one point where Andy's dancing around us, he knows where he's at. He's not trashing anything. And there was no destruction of equipment on that day. However, for studio engineers, that's like The Who trashing their gear. We recorded the song in Montserrat and recorded the video in Montserrat too. It was still kind of just hose down the band with a camera and see what you get and edit it later. Not much in the way of concept with this particular one. They just sent a crew out there to shoot the band. And the band were all really would rather shoot each other. Those recordings were not easy. We understand now, with the wisdom of hindsight, that that struggle made it what it was. But it was not comfy at the time. I've often described the police as a Prada suit made out of barbed wire. Well, now with Every Breath You Take, we're fully high concept. In fact, the concept was the star of the video. It was actually modeled on some kind of French noir film style-y thing. I don't know, I don't watch French films, particularly not stylized ones. But the way it was lit in black and white, and it was all very studied. Every shot was composed, both of the band and of each one of us. And it was a very effective video. It's actually very beautiful. It's a work of art. The video itself, quite beyond the, you know, the song's not bad, but the video itself was kind of a work of art by Kevin Godley and Lol Cream. They were insane to work with. They were a wild party at all times. In fact, they were so crazy that they were officially the directors of the video, but they would have like a sane director to actually do it while they were having wild ideas and being generally inspiring, which they were. I mean, they did kind of, their madness inspired us. And this is one of their finest hours. I don't know what it is about this song that made it so big. I think it could be that it had two major versions, and now a third, by major artists. And so each one had a full run of a number one song. It is a pretty cool song. And one of the composers, Stings, one of his favorite things about it is that everybody misunderstands it. Nothing cheers him up more than when people say, oh yes, we played your song at our wedding. And he goes, mwah. This song with evil intent was misinterpreted as a thing of beauty. Satan comes into our world with a smile on his face. Every step you take, I'll be watching you. Well, this idea of taking police songs and messing them up, deranging, if you will, came about from two different places. One is my life with orchestra. I've been playing shows with orchestra for decades now, commissioned works, film scores, and such. And during some of these shows, I started dropping in obscure police songs that I wrote, not the big hits. But they went over so well and had such an impact, I thought, well, how about we drop some hits in there? And so I started using police songs. The derangements part came from a film that I made about the police. Back in the day, I had a Super 8 film camera and shot everything from the motels all the way up to the stadiums. I got the whole adventure. And eventually it became a film which went to Sundance and had a life of its own. The film score for that had to be police music, but I figured let's go alternative police music. So I went and I found improvisations we did on stage, excursions in the studio that we didn't use, and basically lost police stuff. And I created these other versions of the song for the film. And then when the penny dropped to start playing police songs in these shows, in these orchestral shows, let's orchestrate those versions rather than the standard versions. And so we have the show is deranged for orchestra, which is, you get your favorite police stuff, but I do occasionally play Hide the Hit. And there's a journey. It's all very police-ish. It's all very Andy Summers-ish and all very Sting-ish. But it's police stuff that you haven't heard before.